Well, good evening, Grove family. Hey, we are glad that you are here. We're going to worship the Lord together. We're going to sing a song, an older song, All Creatures of Our God and King. Let's sing his praises together. Let's stand up. If you have breath in your lungs, you have a reason to sing. Come on.
Hallelujah.
I've been thinking about this set this week and the songs that we were gonna do and sing. And when I thought about the songs, a lot of them, most of them, all of them, are reflecting on the dependency that we should have on our God, on our Lord. We've just said, the battle belongs to you. No matter what circumstance, no matter what fear we face, the battle belongs to you. We started off saying that all creatures of our God and King praise him, that you are sustainer of all life. And a lot of times I think in our life, it's easy for us just to forget that the battle belongs to him. What we start doing is we start operating in our own strength, in our own will. And the Lord has been bringing me back to that right now. God's reminding me that my faith is in who God is and how he delivers. Not in what I can do, not in what somebody else can do for me, but the fact that he shows up each and every day in our life. And sometimes we just think we need to do all the things. We need to make it happen. And Francisco actually, on the bass right over here, during our prayer, our huddle, right before we were rehearsing, he mentioned that God has given us the instructions that we need. much like a tabernacle, God has given us the instructions that we need for any circumstance in this life. Anything that we come into contact with. Maybe not the specifics, but maybe right now you're hurting. And God is there. He cares for you. Trust in him. Have faith in him. Maybe right now you're angry. Maybe you're frustrated at something. Man, lean into God. Let him be the one that relieves that fury, that frustration. God has given us all that we need for life and godliness. We need only to trust in him, to lean in him. And so we're going to sing a song about how we look at him and his faithfulness in our lives, and that we know that he will come through each and every day. So let's sing this together, church. And let's not do it in our own strength. Let's do it in the strength and the power of the Holy Spirit that's inside of us.
Night won't last. promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness, your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands. This is my confidence. You never fail. Your promise.
We love you, God. Thank you, Lord, that we can have confidence in your faithfulness. God, that you always show up. Lord, we are never alone. God, and you have given us all that we need to engage this life with you in our hearts and you on the throne. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Amen, ladies and gentlemen. Well, thank you for coming today. We are glad that you are here. Before you sit down, maybe just take a minute. Just look around at the people around you. Just give them a wave. And yeah, if you want a fist bump, maybe you could fist bump.
Well, good evening, Grove family. Good to see you on this Mother's Day weekend. We just want to say, to all the mothers of influence, women of influence here at the Grove, we love you. We thank you. We're thankful for you. I've been going to this church since I was 14 years old, and I'm almost 70. And I can tell you that the women of the Grove have kept this church together for a long time. When the men weren't coming, the women were. And it kept our church doors open, and now we have men and women coming. But ladies of the Grove, I just want to say thank you on this Mother's Day weekend for all you've done. Throughout a Grove history to make us the church we are today. If you're a guest today, whether it's online or here in person, we'd love to connect with you. If online, if you go to the digital connect card, you can fill that out so we can get to know you. And in your bulletin also, there's a connect card. But after the service, if you're here, we have staff members over here in Guest Central who would love to meet with you and answer any questions that you may have. I have three announcements and one request. The first two announcements are for the ladies, and this Saturday you have a garden party and spring marketplace. That's just a great time, fun time, where you can connect with the ladies of the Grove and have a great time doing that. You see, you can sign up online. We hope you do that. It'll just be a great time for you this Saturday, but you need to sign up online. We have a pasta bar after service tonight in honor of the women of influence here at the Grove. And so we want to remind you of that. It'll be fantastic. We also have where you, husbands and children, can build a bouquet for that special woman of your life. And so that's over there as well. Just something you can do and enjoy that time. We want to make the ladies feel special. And we have a request of you also. This Monday, just like Daniel's going to talk about the tabernacle, When it was time to move to another place, they had to pack it up so it could go to the next place. And at 9 o'clock on Monday, we have to pack the tabernacle up so it can go to its next location. So if you can help us, maybe even if you could email us and let us know you'll be there, we really need some help doing that. We'd appreciate it so much. Well, I want to pray for the women of influence here at the Grove. And after I pray, we're going to have a really cool Mother's Day video. Alma and her daughter, Lauren, are going to share, and it's fantastic, and you'll be blessed by it. But let me pray as we start. God, I just come to you on this Mother's Day weekend, and we celebrate women of influence, those incredible ladies who have had children, God, and those, even though they may not have biological children, just like in my life since I was 14 years old here at the Grove, they've had tremendous influence in this church, in their families, in our community. God, we just honor them this weekend, realizing that for some, this is an incredible day, Mother's Day weekend, Mother's Day. they just rejoice in this time. And God, we just pray you'll bless them all the more. We realize also that for some ladies, this is a tough weekend, God. And we pray that you be with them in a special way and just love on them and care for them. But more than anything else today, Father, I would ask you to do this, that you would let every woman of influence here at the Grove know how deeply we love them, how much we appreciate them, not just today, but throughout the years, for all the things they've done to allow us to be the church that we are today. We would not be the church we are today without the Grove Women of Influence. Bless them, God, I pray. We thank you for this time. I pray you be with Pastor Daniel as he comes to continue this series, God. Just speak through him as you have been in the past. And we just give you praise and thanks for all that will happen tonight. In the powerful and wonderful name of Jesus, amen.
My name is Alma.
And my name is Lauren, and this is our God With Us story.
So my story begins with me not being a believer until I actually became a mom. And as a new believer, I was just hungry and searching for some spiritual guidance. So in 2004, we came upon the Grove, and we visited. And my first visit here, I heard Pastor Tom talk about legacy and what legacy you wanted to leave in the world and for your family. And I knew that I didn't want Lauren to have a legacy of despair or hopelessness. So I knew that I wanted her to find hope. And that's why we as a family decided to be all in. And we started volunteering in the early childhood ministry. I started attending Bible study where God's word just became alive. And I joined MOPS. And MOPS is very special because I still have lifelong friends that I've made and accountability partners that have seen me through. And so they have seen me through a lot. Fast forward 7 years, and I saw myself in the middle of a divorce and just asking the Lord, like, why? How is this happening? And just confused and broken and scared. And we were seeing a counselor, and he asked me to keep a journal. And I think it's the best thing I ever did because I have something to look back. And he told me, I want you to listen carefully, and I want you to know that God brought you to salvation to see you through this, because he knew trouble was coming. And just imagine if you weren't saved, how you would be dealing with this, how your choices would affect Lauren. And so just with that, I started to pray, and I was on my knees constantly. I confided in these women that my marriage was breaking up, and they were family friends because we as a family were invested in the church. So it was very humbling and very hard to open up and just talk about our marriage dissolving, and they supported me.
And I think looking back on it, I really saw my mom's faith through it all. She was just phenomenal. I never knew when she had a bad day. She was just so great, and she really is my rock in showing me how to be a faithful, God-fearing woman. And by her faith in the Lord, I think it just has strengthened my faith and my walk in God. And looking back through those years, I have just noticed how God has been with me. He has provided multiple father figures in my life. And those father figures have just shown me what it is to be, again, a God-fearing man, and what it looks like to treat your wife and how to be the head of the household. And, you know, if my mom hadn't decided to come to the Grove in 2004, all those years ago, then those father-like figures, figures probably wouldn't be in my life now. And I'm just so thankful for the community that God has provided us over the years, because they have honestly been such a great blessing in our life. And they are God's hands in our life.
True. And I did. I prayed for that. I prayed that the absence of a father wouldn't, I don't want to say ruin her, but just the absence of a father wouldn't diminish what an awesome person she was, what an awesome person she is. I prayed that the Lord would just show her that she is more than loved, and she is awesome and amazing, and God loves her. And I am so grateful that God placed so many people in our lives, especially male role models. So going through this series, the Exodus story just reminded me that we should never forget all the goodness that God has seen us through. And even the stuff that isn't good, he sees us through the highs and through the lows. And we just have to learn to reach out and ask for help and trust the people that he has put in front of us. And I think for me, that's probably the hardest part as a believer, that I failed. And I failed in my marriage. And that's not the case. You know, God has used us actually together to minister around Riverside and all the different organizations that we're involved in, and all the different volunteer opportunities that we have had in the last couple of years. And had we not gone through what we went through, I don't think we would have been able to bless other people. And that's definitely God with us, because that's not something that her and I did on our own. You know, we were led to help others that have been in our situation, and even others that maybe are suffering more. And that's because, again, we have been taught by God that he is with us always, and he will see us through.
All right. Well, thankful for Alma and Lauren Goodell. Alma works at Cal Baptist University for the head athletic director there, and daughter Lauren goes to CBU too. And you're not going to find a nicer mother-daughter duo. They're just a very, very sweet, sweet family. And except you're like nice moms and daughters too. So there you go. Hey, we're blessed by all the women of the church, just like Tom said. Let me also start by saying Happy Mother's Day to every single person here, and Women of Influence Day. We hope that you feel loved and celebrated and cared for by friends, family, and also your church family. My prayer and hope for every single one of you here today is that God would meet you where you're at. That whatever's going on in your life, whatever you're feeling, whatever you're struggling with, that you would know that God wants to meet you where you're at today. And to all the women that's in this room, let me focus on you just for a second, that God wants to meet each and every single one of you where you're at right now. That he wants to meet the new mother where she's at in lacking sleep, and that she doesn't really feel like herself, thinking like, why do I feel so terrible? God wants to meet you where you're at. That he wants to meet you in the busyness of your life, trying to raise kids and keep things going, feeling like you're not succeeding maybe in anything, trying to manage the job, the home, the husbands. Hopefully you just have one, but all those things, that God wants to meet you in that. That he wants to meet you in the sadness of your kids leaving the home, turning into an empty nester, and what that feels like. Corey, both your kids are gone. See, your son just graduated. A lot of graduations are happening. That's a new season as well, and these new seasons bring about new emotions, and God meets us in those new seasons of life. That God wants to meet you in your brokenness of losing a mom. That God wants to bring you in your hurt and your anger of losing a child. That he wants to meet you in your heartbreak of not being able to have kids at this point in time, and you're asking God why. He wants to meet you where you're at. That he wants to meet the woman who wants to get married and have kids. He wants to meet you where you're at. He wants to meet you in your loneliness, in your disappointment, and in your failures. That God wants to meet you where you're at today and remind you of his love and remind you that he wants to be a part of your life. And here's the thing that I love about God. God's not waiting for us to put ourselves together to meet with us. But God wants to meet us in the mess. God wants to meet us where we're at when we're not even ready to meet him. He comes and says, I want to dwell with you. I want to be with you. I'm right here by your side. And even the video we just watched earlier of Alma mentioning how their counselor at one point in time said this to her, that God brought you to salvation to see you through this. That God brings us to salvation to see us through all different types of things, starting with our sin, that God sent his son Jesus to die on the cross for our sins, that he conquered death, that he defeated the cross, that he defeated sin, he rose again, and he brings us through the punishment that each and every single one of us deserve. That he brings us through to the point that we're saved and we will not experience the wrath of God. We're not going to experience hell for those who call upon the name of Jesus, that he saves us. And if he can bring us through that, well, then he can bring us through any single challenge in our life. That he meets you where you're at to bring you through the mess that maybe you currently find yourself in. And why? Simply because God loves you. He sees you where you're at and he loves you. So let's just start by thanking God. Let's thank him that he sees us in the mess, that he comes to us, that he wants to bring us through it, and that we're not alone. Amen. Father God, we come before you and we praise you. We give you all the glory. We thank you for your goodness in our life. I'm so thankful that you see every single person with where they're at today and that you want to dwell with them, that you want to be with them, that you want to bring them through what they're going through, and just to see that you love them, that you love me. So God, may we see that today, even through the preaching of your word. We pray this in your name. Amen. Today, we continue in our series, Beautifully Designed, as we continue to make our way through the book of Exodus. Today, we're going to be looking at chapters 25 through 27, and we're going to be talking about the tabernacle. The main idea of this sermon is up here on the screen. You can write on your notes if you like. We'd like to take notes at the Grove. It says, the tabernacle was beautifully designed by God to show us his heart, his holiness, and his plan for us to dwell with him in heaven. And all the points will line up with the main point of the sermon today. Now, as we know, we've been studying through the book of Exodus, that the Israelites were in slavery for 400 years. God sent Moses to free them. They were wandering in the wilderness, waiting to get to the promised land. And while in the wilderness, God begins to form a kingdom culture, giving them the Ten Commandments, giving them the Book of the covenant code, which we talked a long time about last week, did we not? And building this kingdom culture, as Trevor Christmas said a couple weeks ago. Now what we're going to see for the rest of the book, like the remaining 16 chapters, is God talking about the tabernacle. In fact, 13 of the 16 remaining chapters in Exodus have to do with the tabernacle. From 25 to 31, it talks about the instructions for the tabernacle. Then from 35 to 40, it's how those instructions should be carried out, how it should be built, how you should move it, and all those things. So if you're going to help move the tabernacle on Monday, read chapter 35 through 40 first. So here's the big thing. When you read through these chapters, a good question to ask is, okay, why the tabernacle? What's it about? What does this mean to us today? Why does it matter? Why isn't Daniel giving us a 5-point sermon on how to be a better mom today? Well, we're going to be talking about this sermon, how God has tabernacled among us. And when you see the point of this, I think this will be even more powerful than that, that God wants to dwell with each and every single one of us today. Now, the tabernacle was a tent. Plain and simple, it was a tent that God instructed the Israelites to set up in the desert. They'd set it up, take it down, depending upon the location that they were going to, and it would serve as a sanctuary for him. Some would even say it just served as a home for God, a place for him to dwell among them. Let's look at Exodus 25, 1 through 9, as we begin to hear even about the materials and how this thing was built. Exodus 25, 1 through 9. The Lord said to Moses, tell the Israelites to bring me an offering. You are to receive the offering for me from everyone whose hearts prompts them to give. These are the offerings that you are to receive from them: gold and silver and bronze, blue and purple and scarlet yarn and fine linen, goat hair. If any of you have some of that, bring that too. Ram skin, dyed red, and another type of durable leather, acacia wood, olive oil for the light, spices for the anointing oil and for the fragrant incense, an onyx stone, and other gems to be mounted on the ephod of the breastpiece. Then have them make a sanctuary for me, and I will dwell among them. Make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern that I will show you, and we'll stop right there. So God says this first. He says, okay, Moses, what are you going to do? You're going to go and tell all the people that you need an offering. You're going to take this offering. And after saying this, it was the only ones that had to give were the ones whose hearts were prompted to give. Anytime you give an offering to the Lord, it's not something that you have to do begrudgingly or like you feel forced to do it. God wants our hearts to be prompted to give to him. And we see that Paul kind of uses similar language in 2 Corinthians 9:7, where it says, each of you should give what you have decided in your heart to give, not reluctantly or under compulsion, for God loves a cheerful giver. He wanted them to be cheerful here in Exodus chapter 25 as well. And with this offering, God was very specific in what he wanted them to give him. He's saying, you know, I want gold and silver and bronze and blue and scarlet yarn and goat hair and ram skin, acacia wood, olive oil, not vegetable oil, but olive oil. And all of these things that he's asking for, this offering, well, it's the materials that are going to be used to build the tabernacle. Now, a good question you might ask this is, where did they get this material from? And they're out in the wilderness. They're having a hard time finding water and food. So where are they going to have gold? Oh, that's a good question. Well, if you remember, when they were in Egypt and they left Egypt, before they left, God told the people of Israel to actually ask the people that are around, the Egyptians, four things before they took off into the wilderness. In Exodus 12, 35 through 36, it says, the Israelites did as Moses instructed and asked the Egyptians for articles of silver and gold and for clothing. That's where the yarn comes into play. The Lord had made the Egyptians favorably disposed towards the people, and they gave them what they asked for. So they plundered the Egyptians. The Egyptians just started giving them things before they took off. Now, I like this because we see this, that anytime God asks us to do something, that he gives us what we need first. Well, not necessarily right away first, but he always gives us what we need to do his will. So God calls for an offering to be had for those whose hearts are willing, and they were to give what God had already given to them. If your heart feels led, I've already blessed you with these things. Give an offering to me, and we'll use this to build the tabernacle. In Exodus 25:8, it says, we see that God is going to do with the offering. It says, then have them make a sanctuary for me with all these things, and I will dwell among them. Douglas Stewart, one of the commentators that I've been studying through, he says this, verse is the simplest and perhaps also the strongest statement in Exodus, a book often described as especially reflecting the theme of the presence of God, God's concern to center himself among his people and to have them organize themselves around them. That God's saying, hey, I want to be with you. I want to dwell with you. I want you to build this sanctuary. We're going to put it in the middle of the camp, and I'm going to dwell among you. Now, the interesting thing is in Numbers chapter 2, it talks about how the camp was supposed to be set up. I mean, you have millions of people. Can you imagine organizing this when you take off and when you go? Well, with the 12 tribes, every single tribe had a place to go with the tabernacle in the middle. Someone just has a drawing here up on the screen that you can see behind me. I mean, you just got to imagine millions of people all the way around with a tabernacle in the middle. Everyone can just, you can see it. You can see it's there, and God wanted to be the center of their lives, and we see it here in this picture. Now, how many of you were able to go to our tabernacle experience this last week? All right. A decent amount of you. We have a picture of, it's kind of like a science project picture of it. This is what I did right here for my fourth grade science project. You don't believe me, do you? No. I did a Kool-Aid taste test for my, yeah. And embarrassing enough, I actually turned in the same project my 11th grade year of high school. Just changed the date and I got an A. Can you believe that? Yeah, there you go. So here's the tabernacle that you can see. You have the altar out front that people are going to come and bring their sacrifices to. Inside is the holy place, the Holy of Holies, the Ark of the Covenant. We'll talk more about that as we go. But it was an interesting thing just even to try to picture it in our minds as we went and walked through it for those of you that were able to. My mom volunteered a couple times this last week. She said that a family, get this, drove down from Sacramento to come and see this. That's crazy. I was like, wow, that's amazing. But they wanted to come and check it out. So it was a blessing to have it there. Now, I think when I was there, I just kept thinking like, man, how crazy it would have been to be a high priest, to be in the holy place, then to go through the curtain into the Holy of Holies, and just what that would have been like. I think that's just kind of what you feel in excitement. In fact, our head security guy, Leo Hitman, he stayed the night a couple nights to make sure that no one graffitied the tabernacle. And he texted a couple of us that he actually set up camp in the Holy of Holies by the Ark of the Covenant. And he was like, Daniel, I just felt too weird. This is his words. A fat, gray-haired guy should not be snoring next to the Holy of Holies in there. I thought that was awesome. So he moved it outside and he had some Del Taco. There's so many people that helped out to make this thing possible, but just to picture what it would have been like is a cool thing to think about. Now, I think the thing that caught my attention the most, the thing that I thought about the most when I was going through the tabernacle experience, is that the creator of the universe, get this, the creator of the universe, God Almighty, he came and dwelt in a tent in a wilderness. That's what he did. That's where he came from. He didn't go to the montage in Laguna. In a tent. I'm just like, wow, why? I mean, really, technically, it's a mobile home that he was in, made out of animal skin and yarn, and this is the location that he came to dwell in. Now, here's the beauty of this all, and this is point number one. The tabernacle was beautifully designed to show God's heart is to dwell among us. This is God's heart. He wanted to dwell among them. He wants to dwell with you. He wants to meet you where you're at, just how I started. I mean, his heart is to be with his people, for his people to be with him. And he's always willing to meet us where we're at in the wilderness of life. I mean, the people of Israel were living in tents during this time. So God came alongside of them, identified with them in their circumstances of what they were going through, and he set up his own tent. You're living in a tent? I'm going to live in a tent. Why? Because God loves his people, and God wanted to be with them. God wanted to be connected to his people. He wanted his people to be connected to him. Now, yes, it was a tent that God dwelled in. Maybe I'm making it sound worse than what it is, because Scripture also tells us that it was a sanctuary in verse 8. The Hebrew word for sanctuary, mikdash, you can see it there, which can also be translated a place of holiness. I mean, it was a place of holiness. Why? Because God's presence was in this tent. Now, the details of the tabernacle that God instructed them to build were beautifully designed and intentionally designed to help the people understand the holiness of God. That yes, God Almighty, the Creator, wanted to be with them, but also he's holy. So you have to picture the tabernacle as an object lesson for the people as well. Point number two in your notes, the tabernacle was beautifully designed to show God's holiness in the details. And you can see the last 13 of the 16 chapters are about details of the tabernacle. Things are very exact in how God wanted things to be. It was a big visual aid of what God wanted them to see. It was an object lesson. In Exodus 25:9, we already read it, but God tells Moses, make this tabernacle and all its furnishings exactly like the pattern that I will show you. So what we see here is that God had a pattern. There was a pattern for the people to follow. There was a plan for the tabernacle and things that were going to go in it, like the ark and the table and the lampstand and the priestly duties that all they had to do. We have another picture here that you can see up on the screen. Just everything had a place, so kind of like a blueprint picture here. Everything had to be followed exactly the way that God outlined for it to be done. It would paint a picture of the holiness of God in heaven and how we are to approach him. I like how this passage says that there's a pattern to follow. I like that. That there's a pattern to follow. Well, what pattern was to be copied? Hebrews 5:8 says this. It refers to the tabernacle as a sanctuary that is a copy and shadow of what is in heaven. Now that's interesting. The Old Testament tabernacle that they were instructed to build in Exodus chapter 25, what we're seeing in Hebrews is that that was a copy and a shadow, a pattern of what was in heaven. Now, what does that mean? Does it mean that there's another tabernacle in heaven of which the one outlined here in Exodus 25 is a symbol? That's exactly what it means. That in heaven there is some type of tabernacle where God dwells, and this is a model of that. So that's intriguing for us. That's something that okay, now I'm interested in that. This was even supposed to make the people want to long to be with God, to long to be in heaven. Hebrews 9:11 says this, "But when Christ came as high priest of the good things that are now already here, he went through the greater and more perfect tabernacle." So Christ himself goes through this tabernacle that's in heaven that is not made with human hands like the one in Exodus 25. That is to say, it's not a part of this creation. He did not enter by means of the blood goats and the calves like we saw in the tabernacle experience where they're having an altar and making sacrifices, but he entered the most holy place once and for all by his own blood, thus obtaining eternal redemption. So there's even a holy place there in heaven. So the tabernacle that God called the Israelites to make was a symbolic representation of the real thing that's in heaven. I just think that's really cool. I think that's exciting. It was a piece of heaven on earth, which makes sense because that's where God's presence dwelled. It was a place of worship. And like I said, it was a place for people to long to go to, heaven that is, to be with God and to fully have him. Now from Exodus 25:10 to the end of 27, we see instructions just on how God wanted the people to build the tabernacle and the courtyard outside of it. Like I said, an ark and a table and a lampstand. A lot of instructions that you can read through. I'm not going to read through all of it because that's why we have the tabernacle experience. How to make the tabernacle, the altar, the burnt offerings, the courtyard. I mean, the people were given the exact details on how it was all supposed to be laid out. Now, the tabernacle experience we just had at our church this last weekend, it laid out all the dimensions. The actual tabernacle itself was the exact same size of the dimensions given in Exodus 25. You can go to the blueprint again. We can check that out. Even the tabernacle itself, it was 15 feet wide. Scripture tells us it was 10 cubits. Anytime you hear the word or cubit in Scripture, it's 18 inches long. So they say most likely it's from your elbow to the top of your middle finger. That's one cubit right there if you're ever having to measure something. So 15 feet wide, 10 cubits, 45 feet long, 30 cubits. You can just see all the details of where things go. The altar and the burnt offering out front, the laver up, the water basin there. We have the candle, the menorah on the left-hand side. The table with the bread of the presence right there on the right as you're walking in. The altar of the incense that the high priest would take before he gets into the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant actually is. And you can see that blueprint there. Then you can turn to the next slide where it's kind of more of like a Lego picture inside. So you can see the lampstand and the table and the priest and the that curtain, that's the curtain that tore when Jesus died on the cross, and the Holy of Holies that is inside. I mean, this is God's house. This is where he dwelled. So even when you look inside, every house needs a light, right? Every house needs a table with bread on it. And where's God? He's in the back of the house. He's dwelling in the back. This is his house. This is where he was. So the first thing that they were instructed to build as you're going through Exodus 25 was the Ark of the Covenant, the most important piece. It didn't start with the tent itself, but the Ark. So why don't we look at Exodus 25, 10 through 22, as you can just see the details that God gives Moses and how to build the Ark of the Covenant. It was a real thing. It's not just something fake in the Indiana Jones movie. So here it is. Have them make an ark of acacia wood, 2.5 cubits long, 1.5 cubits wide, and 1.5 cubits high. Overlay it with pure gold, both inside and out, and make a gold molding around it. Cast four gold rings for it and fasten them to its four feet with two rings on one side and two rings on the other. Then make poles of acacia wood and overlay them with gold. Insert the poles into the rings on the sides of the ark and carry it. The poles are to remain in the rings of this ark. They are not to be removed. Then put in the ark the tablets of the covenant law, which I will give you, the Ten Commandments. It goes on to say, make an atonement cover of pure gold. That's also known as the mercy seat. 2.5 cubits long and 1.5 cubits wide, and make two cherubim out of hammered gold at the ends of the cover. Make one cherub on one end and the second cherub on the other. Make the cherubim of one piece with the cover at the two ends. The cherubim are to have their wings spread upward, overshadowing the cover with them. The cherubim are to face each other, looking toward the cover. Place the cover on top of the ark and put in the ark the tablets of the covenant law that I will give you. There above the cover, between the two cherubim that are over the ark of the covenant law, I will meet with you and give you all my commands for the Israelites. So this is where God is going to meet and talk with the high priest and talk with Moses. People argue, was Moses able to go in the Holy of Holies, or was he just in the holy place and God was speaking from this spot? Now, it's very important to realize that this represented, this Ark of the Covenant, who God was. God is not a box, all right? He's not. Do not put God in a box, all right? Pun intended. The Ark would symbolize the presence of God. The ark would symbolize his presence. The tabernacle would house it. It would also, the Ark of the Covenant would have the Ten Commandments inside of it. Do you remember the other two things that would be in it? It would also have the manna that would be in it later on, and then also Aaron's staff that budded that would also be in it. And all of this would just be a symbol of the covenant that God made with the people of Israel. The lid of the ark was called the atonement cover or the mercy seat, and it was made of pure gold that symbolized really like the throne of God, the place where God would stand. And the cover had two cherubim facing each other on it. Now, where's the other place in Scripture before this where the cherubim are mentioned? Can you remember? It's mentioned in Genesis chapter 3. In 3:24, this happens after Adam and Eve are kicked out of the garden, and then God places the cherubim guarding the garden so that no one else can go inside and eat of the tree of life and live forever. That's the only other time before this that we see the cherubim in Scripture. So we see these cherubim as powerful creatures that guarded really the presence of God. And the Ark of the Covenant, it was in the Holy of Holies. You look at the Lego version of the tabernacle again, you can see that. No one went back there. You and I would never be allowed to go into the Holy of Holies. In fact, a common worshiper would never be allowed to go in the holy place. For us, if we were just a common worshiper during that time, the only place that we can go to is in the outer courtyard, where we're going to bring a sacrifice for it to be burned and ask for forgiveness of our sins. The priests were allowed to go into the holy place, which is that larger section, but then the Holy of Holies, they could only go in there one time a year on the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. That was the only day they could go in there, in the holy place, to take care of the assignments that God had given to them. The courtyard is where we would go. So all of this is, like I said, a walking illustration of who God is, how God wants to be with us. But the other thing about the tabernacle that's interesting is that it shows us that God's presence is limited, because his presence was there, and yet you could not even go inside and experience his presence for yourself in that very personable way. Now, it's good for us to keep in mind that the tabernacle is not the first time that God came to dwell with his people. It's not the first time. It's the second time. What's the first time that God came to dwell with his people? Anyone, just yell at me. The garden. That was the first time. Heard someone say that. So let's even think about just like the story of God dwelling with us. Chapter one of that story of God dwelling with us is in the Garden of Eden, that God created the world. He put Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. In Genesis 3, it talks about how God walked in the garden in the coolness of the day, that God dwelt with mankind in the garden. That was incredible. But when sin entered the world, no longer did man have this special access to the presence of God in the sense that, like, God dwelt with them. Now, was God still in the world? Yes. Did God still communicate with Adam and Eve? But there's something that's different about just this aspect of God dwelling with the people in the garden. We see that there was something different before the fall. Then the fall happened. Now, chapter two of God dwelling with his people is the tabernacle. And many people will even call the tabernacle like a mini version of Eden. Why? Because the front gates of the Garden of Eden were in the east. Same thing with the tabernacle. That's how it was instructed. It would be facing the east. It was guarded by the cherubim, just like the Garden of Eden. The lampstand, some people think that represented the tree of life. When you walked in, it'd be on the left-hand side. Also, the law of God, many people would say that represented the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And then you have God dwelling in the tabernacle, but it's still not full access. It's not even the same like it was in the Garden of Eden. There's something that's different. But here's the thing that many people point out, that it was a step towards the restoration process that would one day be completed in the new heaven and the new earth where we would dwell with God forever. So going on to chapter 3, the story of God dwelling with his people. After the tabernacle comes the temple. The temple that Solomon constructed. This temple was intended to be permanent. It was most likely constructed in the exact same way that the tabernacle was, but it was twice the size. It used different materials. Why? Because it was a permanent structure that was there, but it was in the center of Jerusalem. I mean, it's there for all of God's people to see, the center of Israel's religious activities, and God dwelled there while the Ark of the Covenant was there. A couple stories of it being taken away, and that's a whole other story. So let's go on. Story of God dwelling with us. After that, the next thing that we see of how God dwells with his people is when we get to chapter 4, we're calling it, and that's Jesus, of Jesus dwelling with us in the flesh. In John 1:1, it says, "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God." When you get to John 1:14, it says, "The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, that we've seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth." Now, the interesting thing to point out is that the Greek word for dwelling, which is skano, is very similar and related to skine, which is the Greek translation of the Hebrew Old Testament for the Septuagint. It's just showing how similar those words are. The tabernacle of the Old Testament, same word being used to describe Jesus who came and dwelled, or what people would say, tabernacled among us, which is why you may have heard the saying that Jesus came and tabernacled among us. He dwelt among us. That's why the title of this sermon is that God has come and tabernacled among us, that God took on flesh, that he took on a temporary human body. He took on a tent. And just like I said earlier, that God came alongside his people in the Old Testament, and he identified with them and the circumstances that they were going through, and we see that Jesus does the exact same thing. That God comes down in the flesh, in a temporary body, that he identifies with us in our sufferings, he identifies with us in our temptations, and he dwells among us. In John 2:19, it says, "Jesus answered them, 'Destroy this temple, and I will raise it again in 3 days.'" And if you read that passage, you know they were confused. Like, what are you talking about? That temple took a long time to build. But God was talking about himself, because God is the tabernacle, because God is the temple, because he's God Almighty who came to dwell with each and every single one of us. He's just the new and improved tabernacle. And we have seen the glory of God who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. The only person who saw the glory of God was the high priest who went into the Holy of Holies. But Jesus shows us the glory of the Father. Now think about this. If the Old Testament was a representation of heaven,
Well, how much better is Jesus? He's a lot better. In fact, in Hebrews chapter 1, it talks about how Jesus is the exact representation of God the Father's being. We're seeing who God the Father is in Jesus. Now, like I said earlier, the tabernacle was established to connect people to God the Father and his presence. That's what Jesus did. It's exactly what he did. In dying on the cross for our sins and paying the price and being that sacrifice, he was the ultimate sacrifice that paid the atonement for our sins, which tore the curtain from the Holy of Holies. When you hear about that, and you may have wondered this before, like God died on the cross and the curtain tore, what does that mean? Well, when you see the curtain and the Holy of Holies being torn, now we all have access to the presence of God. He's the high priest that has made the way for us to go into the presence of God the Father. Point number three on your notes is this: the tabernacle was beautifully designed to show God's plan for Jesus and for heaven. That when we see the tabernacle in the Old Testament, it's giving us a greater picture of who Jesus Christ is, who he would be, what he would do. It's pointing us to Jesus. Like I said, all this to say, the Old Testament tabernacle points us to Jesus and what he would do. The tabernacle as a whole comes to a fulfillment in Jesus Christ. That's why we don't have a temple today. We do not have a temple. We do not have an altar where we come and bring a lamb and sacrifice to the Lord. Why? Because the Lamb of God was sacrificed and made atonement for our sins once and for all. We see that in Hebrews 10:10, where it goes on to say, "And by that we have been sanctified through the offering of the body of Jesus Christ once and for all." It has been done. So if you wonder, and I've wondered this when I was in college and I was studying to become a pastor, how do things change? Why do they change from the New Testament to the Old Testament? What is that? Well, you're just seeing God's plan develop. His plan developing in how he wants to dwell with his people. I think it's a fascinating thing to see how God planned these things out. Now, once Jesus resurrected from the grave and Jesus goes up to heaven, then God sends his Holy Spirit, and now God dwells in each and every single one of us. So chapter 5 in this story that we're putting together of God dwelling with his people, our bodies are now the temple. If you've heard that, that comes straight from Scripture. 1 Corinthians 6, 18 through 20, it says, "Flee from sexual immorality. All other sins a person commits are outside the body, but whoever sins sexually sins against their own body. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit who is in you, whom you have received from God? You are not your own. You are bought at a price. Therefore, honor God with your body." So the tabernacle in the Old Testament was the place that people would go to and give praise and worship to God. And now we now give praise and worship to God as his temple. We are that, is what Scripture is saying. It's not just something that we do at church, but it's something that we do with our very lives. You don't have to come to church to meet with God. God can meet you where you're at in your life, but all of us coming together, we form the church. God dwells in each and every single one of us, and together as the church, we praise God and give him the glory that he deserves. That's why I think it's funny sometimes when people say that, you know, you act different at church. You know, hey, we're at church. Shh, don't cuss at church. Be appropriate, church. Don't say that bad joke. We're at church. You know, as we think that there's something extra special here just at church. Well, here's the thing. In this plan that we see, God didn't take up residence at the church, as in the building. He takes up residence in each and every single one of us. He resides in your body. So if you're afraid to cuss at church, you should be afraid to cuss anywhere, because God resides in you. And that's why Paul is rebuking the people here in this passage in 1 Corinthians 6, 18 through 20. He's rebuking them for those who are participating in sexual immorality, pretty much saying that how can you think of doing these things? How can you think of participating in these things because God dwells inside of your body? Whatever would seem to be unthinkable to do at church should be unthinkable for us to do in our everyday lives, because God dwells in each and every single one of us. And I know that in our lives, there's different decisions that you have to make every single day, that you have decisions that you can do what's right or you can do what's wrong, and you're trying to think, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? But even just having that thought in your mind that God dwells in you, that God lives in you, and that you are not your own, but that you were bought with a price. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. Honor God with every single decision that you make, because God dwells in each and every single one of us. And I've thought that many times, just in even making decisions, if I'm not going to honor the Lord, just thinking, God, I know that you're inside of me, and I want to praise you with every single decision that I make in my life. Point number three on your notes. The tabernacle was beautifully designed to show God's plan for Jesus and for heaven. And we see that. That's chapter number six as we're going through the story of God dwelling with us. The conclusion is heaven, where God is going to dwell with us for eternity. If you have your Bibles, you can turn them to Revelation 21 through 4. It's going to be our last passage. But just so that we can picture the conclusion of it all, of God dwelling with his people, it says, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and there was no longer any sea. I saw the holy city, the new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride, beautifully dressed for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, 'Look, God's dwelling place is now among the people, and he will dwell with them. They will be his people, and God himself will be with them and be their God. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death or mourning or crying or pain, for the old order of things has passed away.'" And just to think about that as we close today, and all of these stories that we have, and just the tabernacle and the purpose of the tabernacle, that God has always wanted his people to see, that God wants to dwell with you, that God wants to meet you where you're at. And for the people in the Old Testament, as they're out in the wilderness, God wanted an illustration for them to realize that he was going to live among them, he was going to be there, that all the people during that time could count on them. So he set up a tent in the middle of the camp. And we see the same thing with Jesus, and Jesus coming to this earth, taking on flesh and living among us, that he sympathizes with our weaknesses, that he sympathizes with our temptations, and that he wants to be with you in your life. Know this today, and I know we're just going over the tabernacle and different details of it, but God wants to dwell with you. He wants to meet you where you're at, so that you can see his love, experience his love, but more than anything too, so that he can bring you through your sin, that you will call upon the name of the Lord and be saved through what Jesus Christ did on the cross for your sins, that you would give him glory. And the end prize of it all is that you'd be able to dwell with God in heaven for eternity. The greatest part of heaven is not just seeing our families and friends that have gone, but the greatest part of heaven is that we get to dwell with God for eternity and have him. And that's something that we should long for. I know that there maybe might be a family member or a friend that was brought to church today by a mom asking you to come to church. And for those of you who came to church just because you love your mom so much, I'm so glad that you came, really am. But know this, wherever you're at in your life, God wants to meet with you too. He wants to dwell in your life. And maybe this is the time in your life where you let him in and you call upon the name of the Lord and you say, "Yeah, God, I want to believe in you. I want to have a relationship with you." And like I said earlier, you don't have to get yourself ready and prepped to come to God. God wants to meet you in the mess of your life because he loves you so very much. So even if you'd like to give your life to the Lord today, accept him as your Lord and Savior, would you just say this with your heart as I say this prayer and ask him in your life? "God, I believe in you. I believe in you, and I know that I'm a sinner. I'm so thankful that you sent your son to die on the cross for my sins. And I want you to come into my life today. I believe that you died. I believe that you rose again. And I ask for forgiveness of my sins. And I pray that you would help me to live for you. Show me what it means for you to dwell in my life. And help me to live for you today. Pray all of this in your name. Amen. At this time, the worship band's going to sing this song as we worship him. Afterwards, we'll have prayer partners. So why don't we stand as we praise the Lord together.
all I want. It's all you are. Will you meet me here again? Father, we thank you, God, that you are here. You are always near. God, we can trust you. And Lord, that you have desired throughout history to make your place with your people. What a gift. We are thankful and so undeserving, but we thank you, God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, thank you so much for coming this evening. I just want to remind you a few things as you leave. If you are new, right over here at Guest Central, we want to meet you. We want to tell you about the Grove, ways you can get involved. We have prayer partners in the front. They would love to pray with you today. Maybe you made a decision to follow Christ. Man, tell somebody here. Also, we have fellowship and food out in the courtyard with new pavers on the ground. It's going to be awesome, so you're going to want to go ahead and check that out, hang out there. And if you are a mother, well, we're going to be making bouquets for the mothers, so that's available also out in the lobbies. But we love you, church. We'll see you next week.